Last week, I talked about rethinking what you build and what you don't build. I gave the example of a new trend in sites that refuse to store users' passwords at all and to only allow logins via magic links. I'm not saying you have to do that. It's just one example of how the way you might be used to doing things might not be the best in a project designed to be hands-off as possible. So today, I'm going to go deeper. To give me a framework for this discussion, I've chosen to talk about a set of practices called the 12-factor app, which you can find at the address right here, if you want to look at it yourself. Now, before I start trashing this thing, I want to emphasize that you could do a lot worse as a starting point than these 12 factors. Web apps that are built with these principles are definitely better than a lot that I've seen in the wild, and it's good to have some structure, especially when you're a beginner. And I applaud what the folks behind the site were trying to do. But it's inevitable that anyone who tries to boil down all of software development to 12 bullet points is going to have to drastically simplify, make a lot of assumptions, gloss over potential exceptions, and unavoidably omit things. And 12-factor isn't as limiting as, say, Git flow. And as far as I'm concerned, it has certainly done much less damage to the industry than Agile or Scrum or LeetCode interviews or, God forbid, the SOLID acronym. That stuff is just... This is United Bugs. My name is Carl. I've been a software professional for more than 35 years now, and I'm trying to do my part to reduce the number of bugs on the internet. So let me set the stage here and talk about general trends in software development before I talk about the 12-factor app framework specifically. As software has become more complex and its practitioners have become more specialized, there are certain patterns that people have fallen into, and this 12-factor app is indicative of some of them. Specifically, there's a tendency to adopt practices that make it simpler and faster to build software that works under most circumstances at the expense of being able to troubleshoot and debug those circumstances when the software doesn't work right. Those practices put abstraction layers, obfuscation layers really, between the architecture of the high-level code and what the code actually does. Those practices, like the 12-factor app and many others, enable software that is of lower quality and harder to troubleshoot to get put into production a lot faster than it would have been otherwise. Huh, that sounds familiar. Something that writes software really fast, but that causes the software to be buggier and harder to understand. Now, where have I heard that before? Anyway, I need to establish one more thing before we go forward. In this video and in past videos, I talk a lot about practices that make things easier to program, but make things harder to debug. That's pretty abstract, and I want you to get a feel for what I'm talking about. So let me give you a concrete example. Let me tell you a story about the time I broke Amazon. Well, not all of Amazon, just Amazon's ability to balance their books so they could publish their quarterly reports. Not that that's important. So some details have been changed and simplified to avoid giving away any secrets and to make the story take a little less time to tell, but this is more or less what happened. So I was working in Amazon Logistics, building the offering used by the Amazon delivery drivers that drop off the packages on your porch and take a picture of it and then leave. So I was working on the fulfillment side of Amazon, and somewhere else in Amazon, probably in Seattle, was a system that did the ordering side of Amazon. And of course, since the ordering side and the delivery side were dealing with the same order numbers and the same products and the same addresses and the same customers, et cetera, those systems had to talk to each other somehow, and the somehow was with a message queue. Now, as I've talked about before, I was testing our system myself by buying things with my own money that needed to be delivered to me and then going to the fulfillment center, signing in to be the delivery driver, and then delivering my own packages on my delivery driver account so that I was both the delivery person and the recipient at the same time on two different accounts on two different sides of Amazon. So early on in our test phase, sometimes, for some reason, after I delivered a package, the app I used on the ordering side of the transaction would lock up. Now, this has all been merged into the main Amazon mobile app now, but at the time, same-day purchases were done in a separate app that was called Prime Now. So what was happening was that when the "it has been delivered" message was sent on my side, it was sometimes being rejected by the order side of the house, and then that was causing the Prime Now app to freak out. And that order just was frozen in the system and couldn't be closed. Not always, though, just sometimes. And I was completely at a loss as to what the hell could be going wrong. So I'm trying to figure out what's going on. Turns out the folks on the order side were also trying to figure out who was sending these bad orders, and it took far too long for me to end up in communication with them. And then we had to figure out what was going on, and finally we figured it out. And I'll save you the comedy of errors of all that, but it turns out that the message being exchanged via the message queue had a string field that was basically a delivery ID field, and that field was generated on my side, and it got saved in their database as a foreign key to be used for reconciliation later. The string I was using was a composite value. I was using an algorithm, and I was combining the item ID and the driver ID and the date and some other info so that given a delivery ID, I could decompose it and figure out what that ID represented for troubleshooting purposes. But that made that string a variable length, and it turned out that the Swagger specification document on my side of the transaction for that field had a maximum length value that was a bit larger than the maximum length value of that field in their system. And so if that string happened to get built of values that caused the ID to be at the maximum of what my Swagger document said was okay, it would get rejected on their side because it was too long. But if it wasn't too long, and it was different set of orders that just happened to create a smaller, shorter string, then it worked just fine. But before we figured out that information, it was virtually impossible for me, when I'm looking at my database records and of orders, what was accepted and what was rejected, and trying to figure out what was going on, I had no idea what was going on. And it was definitely impossible for them to tell on their side, because all the information relevant to understanding the problem at all was being hidden by the abstraction that was this message queue. So we got that figured out eventually, and I just ended up creating a UUID to put in that field, and then just made a lookup table to get from that UUID to the other order details that I wanted. And all was well until the end of the quarter, when one of those frozen unreconciled orders happened to have a gratuity amount attached to it that had been pulled from my credit card as a customer as part of the order, but that amount had not been paid to me as the delivery person. And so there was a mad scramble to get that amount to be balanced so that the accounting software could be happy and they could figure out the quarterly report. Fun times. Anyway, that message queue was one of those techniques I'm talking about. It made it possible for Amazon to get that system into production without having to go through all the time-consuming processes of getting my team to interface directly with their team and all the other teams whose stuff we talked to, and it saved a bunch of time on all the different sides until something didn't work, at which point it would have been so much easier to debug if there had just been a direct connection. If my code had directly received an error from their SQL database that said maximum length exceeded for field deliver ID, the first time something went wrong, it would have taken me 5 minutes to fix the whole thing, and we could have avoided the whole nightmare. For a project the size of this at Amazon and a company the size of Amazon, a message queue is exactly the correct kind of architecture, because there were so many teams involved and the system is so complicated, the queue actually made things simpler. And even with the problems that popped up, it ended up, I'm sure, saving time. However, if you're a small team, or really if you're a solo team, building a software as a service project, then that trade-off is very different, which means that if you use that technique to get to market faster, when, not if, but when something goes wrong, one of two things is going to happen. Either you're going to spend more time troubleshooting the problem than you save taking the shortcut in the first place, or you'll do what most of the internet does, which is shrugging your shoulders, closing the ticket as cannot reproduce, and hope it doesn't happen very often. Now, given that I am someone who professionally complains about the internet having too many bugs already, you can tell where my preference would be. Great, now it's 8.5 minutes in, and it's time to start the actual subject of the video. So, I'm not going to go into detail for each of the 12 points. Instead, I'm going to talk about the limitations that these ideas cause and how those limitations relate to the different points. So starting off, we're going to talk about items 1 and 3, one code-based tracked and revision control, and store config in the environment. So here's the information losing extraction in that case. In order to debug problems, you often need to recreate a version of your application as it existed at some point in the past. How does this help? Because once you can reliably reproduce a problem, one of the fastest ways to fix the problem is to answer the question, when did this bug appear and what code changed between the commit before the bug existed and the commit after it did? This is what git bisect is for. The resolution process, if that feature never was implemented correctly in the first place, is very different than when you find out that it was somehow caused by this specific 3-line code change that happened last month. If you have a single code base that contains everything and a .env file that's not under version control, and you want to run your software as it was a month ago, but in between that time, you've made a bunch of changes to your architecture or your operations environment, like say you chose hosting providers from AWS to Google Cloud or something, and you're trying to figure out if the bug was introduced as part of the vendor change or if it was broken before the switch, how would you do that? You need to deploy your old code to the new cloud or reinstate your old cloud. But when you check out your code base from back then to deploy a test build, all the test scripts and build scripts and deployment processes, et cetera, are all pointing at the old cloud. Or those scripts don't exist anymore at all because you never check them in. Now that seems drastic. How often do you change cloud providers? But I'm just using that as an example to make it easier for you to understand. Trust me when I say that build processes and scripts are updated all the time. And even little changes that don't seem to be a big deal can add up to an incredibly time-consuming process when you're trying to deploy an old build. So here's what years of bitter experience has taught me is the best practice. You need three pieces. First, you need the code base with your application code in it. That's more or less like what the 12-factor app is talking about. Then you want a completely different repository that contains all of your scripts and automation for all of your builds, deployments, continuous integration, environments, all that kind of stuff that's all checked into source control so you can track it over time. So if you want to deploy your code from a month ago to the new Kubernetes cluster you just built last week, you can. It might take some tweaks to get everything running, but you've got ready access to all the information between the new deployment repo and the old code repo. I could go into a lot more detail about how this works, and I will probably make a whole video about that at some point, but hopefully you at least understand the concept of what I'm describing. But remember I said you need three things? The third thing you need is some encrypted thing that you use to keep all of your secrets and passwords and such in. Most cloud providers have their own service for this, AWS Secrets Manager, Google Cloud Secret Manager, or there are a number of other choices, third-party software, self-hosted, open source stuff, a managed service, whatever. That stupid ENV file contains all of the passwords needed to connect to all of your databases, and that is one of the most common vulnerabilities by which customer information gets stolen. So here's a story about a botnet that just crawls the internet looking for unsecured ENV files. And here's an article for 6 months ago about 110,000 domains that were exploited because of ENV files. You don't want to end up in that situation. Multiple times over the years, I've been working on networks that were hacked. Several times, I've been the one that discovered the hack while it was in progress. And then I've had to clean up after the networks were compromised. And that's not fun at all, not to mention having to talk to customers about the information that was stolen. I'm sure I'll get to tell some of those stories at some point. So if you possibly can, avoid anything that is commonly used by the bad guys to hack systems. And the good news is, if you're building a system and you're your own boss, then you can choose what you do and don't use. It's often not the case when someone else is making the decisions. And this idea of a secret service brings up another issue, namely the idea that the 12-factor app environment is intended to be explicitly agnostic to the environment that it's run in. There's not a specific bullet point for this, but it's inherent in a couple of statements like do not rely on the implicit existence of any system tools like ImageMagick or curl, which is in point 2 dependencies, or the 12-factor app is completely self-contained, which is in point 7, which is on port binding. This agnosticism of which cloud you're on or whatever is entangled with a thing called Conway's Law. I talk about that a lot. It's about the inevitable similarities between the organization of the software design and the organization of the people in the company that produce and run the software. In a big company, the ideal situation is that the operations team that keeps things running ought to be able to move an application from one cloud vendor to another without having to get the development team involved at all because no code changes would be required. But again, that layer of abstraction that isolates the application from what cloud it's in, it comes at a cost. It can lead to stupid lowest denominator practices like storing passwords in plaintext.env files instead of being able to use vendor-specific services that allow things to actually be secure. And it also leads to a bunch of information hiding stuff that makes debugging harder, kind of similar to the way that the message queue obscured the specific SQL error message that I needed from getting back to the developer that caused a problem, me, in my Amazon story. And that leads into the next issue I have with 12-factor, which is that it assumes an inherent isolation and separation between the development team and the production server environment. In other words, the people that operate the production servers are different people than the people that wrote the application that runs on those servers. Again, this is what protects against insider theft in a huge company, but it allows bugs to be incredibly difficult, if not impractical, to solve. And that disconnect is also an opportunity for security issues to be exploited, again, like those dummy ENV files. Can you tell I don't like those? So this is another one where there isn't a specific point in the 12-factor bullet points. It's a thread that kind of runs through several of them, like it's impossible to make changes to the code at runtime since there's no way to propagate those changes back to the build stage, which is in bullet 5, build, release, and run. Or expecting future requests from the same visitor to be routed to the same process, which is called sticky sessions. That's a violation of 12-factor and should never be used or relied upon according to bullet 6, which is called processes. There have been many bugs in my career that have been most judiciously resolved when I personally log directly into the production runtime servers to look at things and occasionally even make changes. So I have made code changes directly to a backend server at 3 o'clock in the morning because a particular transaction request that kept coming in was causing the service to crash, and it needed to get fixed quickly before we violated our service level agreements and had to pay huge fines. So I just coded directly onto that server and put it into production. I have intentionally crashed one of the web servers in a big production cluster so that I can dump the application's memory and go through it in a debugger in order to diagnose a performance problem. It turned out that a change that we had made to make heavier use of the link lambda functions was causing the C# just-in-time compiler that was building the lambdas and the C# garbage collector that was cleaning the lambdas up were combined, taking up the vast majority of CPU time on the whole server, leaving no time for the server to actually, run the stupid application code it was supposed to be running. That one was a nightmare because it only appeared when the box was under heavy load, and we were never able to reproduce the problem in the lab even after we knew what the problem was. I've also made a special server build in a different project which had so much extra logging that the server ran several hundred times slower than normal. And then I configured the front-end load balancer to route to that server, that part of the cluster, only for the sessions that met a specific set of criteria that we had identified as being involved in a bug we couldn't figure out. And the next time a session came along that triggered the bug, it happened on that specific logging build. We got an impractically huge amount of extra local log files that we couldn't have been able to support on the whole cluster. And then I dissected those log files over the course of several days to figure out and fix what was actually going on. For the record, that is also disallowed under item 11, logs of the 12-factor app. I have no idea how I would have successfully resolved any of those three issues under the constraints and requirements of the 12-factor app. But if I had, I know it would have taken much, much longer. And more likely, management would have just decided to ignore or try to avoid the problem, like all those companies who had their customer data stolen because of their use of .env files. So at this point, I've touched on 7 of the 12 factors in the 12-factor app, and hopefully that's given you enough to think about for a while. I have a few other less fundamental gripes with 12-factor, but instead of making this video even longer, now that I've gotten the really important ones out of the way, I'm just going to put those in my next supplemental newsletter issue, along with any current events that I think shed important new light on things that I've said in previous videos. You can sign up for that using the link right here on your screen or down in the description. So I hope this has been useful to you and it's helped you see how software principles that seem perfectly reasonable when you're thinking only as an application developer can have huge consequences that can lead to more internet bugs. And I hope we can all agree that we don't need any more internet bugs, because the internet is full of these kinds of bugs, and a lot of them are caused by people who are trying to sell you something that they say will make your development go faster while downplaying or just ignoring the trade-offs you would be making by using their product. Excuse me. So until next time, thanks for watching. Let's be careful out there.